There have been folks on the left and right who wanted to see America leave Afghanistan after 20 years. They asked, what's the worst that could happen? We now know the answer. The Taliban back in control of the country with its medieval morality. And the worst yet to come. Women and girls denied basic human rights. Horrific memories of soccer stadium executions spurring a chaotic attempt to flee the country before it's too late. All just days before the 20th anniversary of 9/11. One alternative would have been leaving a small residual force of troops at Bagram Air Base to support the Afghan army, at least until the Taliban complied with the terms of the peace deal. Could have avoided this, at least for a time. Now that is President Joe Biden's road not traveled. He inherited America's longest war, but the final implosion of 20 years' work occurred on his watch. But don't even begin to believe the Republican effort to whitewash history and score partisan points over the fall of Afghanistan. You know, like the RNC's attempt to literally erase praise for Donald Trump's Afghan withdrawal plan from its website in the wake of this disaster. Because, in case you forgot, Trump drew down U.S. troops from around 14,000 to some 2,500, while initiating U.S. talks with the Taliban in Doha without the allied Afghan government even having a seat at the table. So while former Trump Secretary of State Mike Pompeo was busy dunking on President Biden, he was hoping everyone would forget his own negotiations with the Taliban and his commitment to have, quote, zero U.S. forces in Afghanistan by spring 2021. That's right. Because last year, Trump was crowing about this withdrawal deal that was supposed to take place in May, saying, we had very good conversation with the leaders of the Taliban today. They're looking forward to getting this ended. We're looking forward to getting it ended. And I think we all have a very common interest. The relationship is very good that I have with the mullah. You get that?
The relationship is very good that I have with the mullah.
All right, let's get real. No one has a good relationship with the mullah. The Taliban are not trustworthy. They're not going to prevent terrorism on their territory, as they promised Trump, which is why the Trump administration pressuring the Afghan government to release 5,000 Taliban prisoners, including some who'd been linked to the killing of U.S. troops, contributed to this disaster. But one issue that united almost all members of Congress was the moral obligation to protect Afghan interpreters who risked their lives to aid our effort. That's why there was a lopsided 417-16 vote in the House to expand and accelerate their visas. But take a closer look at those 16 no votes. All Republicans, including charter members of Trump's Sedition Caucus, like Andy Biggs, Loewen Boebert, Mo Brooks, Paul Gosar, Marjorie Taylor Greene, Jody Heiss, and Scott Perry. So don't buy the mock outrage over Biden's botched withdrawal from this crew. Last month, they weren't even willing to offer assistance to the Afghans who helped us. And Arizona's Andy Biggs was pressuring Biden for a complete withdrawal back in February. Biggs' insistence that, quote, Afghanis need to be responsible for their own destiny going forward doesn't seem to apply when Joe Biden backs it. Look, the GOP can try to ignore the fact that most of them backed Trump's withdrawal plan despite its reversal of the party's post 9/11 consensus. They dropped those principles for political gain, and they can't just pick them up again to use as a political weapon. Just in case anyone's still tempted to buy into this BS, here's a clip of ex-President Trump bragging about being the author of this withdrawal less than 2 months ago.
I started the process, all the troops are coming back home, they couldn't stop the process. 21 years is enough, don't we think? 21 years. Yeah, thank you, thank you.
He added that the only way the Afghan government lasts is if we're there. And that's your reality check.